Good evening, everyone. First of all, I request all of you to stand up in 2 minutes of silence as a homage to the martyrs of Uri. Thank you, everyone. I, Dikshit Jain, on behalf of Vande Mataram, welcome all of you to today's lecture, Truth About Kashmir and Kashmiri Pandits. Before starting the program, I would request all of you to stand at your place and sing national song Vande Mataram with us.
Vande Mataram, Sujalam, Sufalam, Malaj Sheetalam, Shastra Shyamalam, Mataram, Vande Mataram,
Today we have a very special personality with us who is well known as Voice of Kashmiri Pandits and co-founder of Roots in Kashmir. My dear friend, please welcome Shri Sushil Pandit Ji with a round of applause. Shri Sushil Pandit Ji studied BSc Economics in Delhi University and MA Chinese in JNU. He worked with Indian Express and the Telegraph in mid-80s and then worked with McCain and Contract in 90s. He is an adjunct faculty for teaching strategic media planning at the Indian Institute of Mass Communication and National Institute of Advertising. He has promoted The Hive since 2000. He is the founder and former chairman of Exchange for Media Group and publisher of Prasnath, a quarterly journal on the culture and identity of Kashmir. He is a member in the managing committee at the Ramakrishna Mission Hospital, Vrindavan. He is also president and promoter of Hindustan Football Club, New Delhi, and the past president for Rotary Club of Delhi Midwest. I welcome you, sir. Please occupy the chair on the dais. As per our tradition, I would like to invite Dr. Mahesh Panchanagula to welcome our guest on behalf of Vande Mataram by presenting the fruit basket. Thank you, sir. Now I would request our guest, Sri Sushil Pandit Ji, to address the audience.
Okay.
also and beyond those industries. That's okay.
Yeah, it's okay. I can take both the options as and when needed. I will move out from here. Thanks. Vande Mataram, Vanakkam, Namaskar. I'm really grateful to the Vande Mataram group, to Dr. Tripathi, for a very warm invitation to be amongst you and for a very generous introduction. It has been a long wait for me to be here, and I'm really truly delighted because IIT Madras is one of the great institutions that entire country is proud of. It has always been in news for a lot of interesting reasons. And that was yet another reason for me to be here. And I was truly floored by the lush green campus that you have given yourself and maintained it so immaculately. It is really mood elevating to be here within the campus and amongst you. So I express my gratitude again for hosting me here. The reason why you've called me here is to know more about Kashmir and Kashmiri Hindus. It is a given that the kind of country, the kind of diversity in that country, and the kind of pulls and pressures of being a democracy and a plural society we are. We are always faced with several challenges. And one of the challenges is to actually know a lot about who we are from different corners of this land and how we've journeyed to be where we are today. In the kind of age we are living in, there is in any case a lot of information overload. And with this added information about our history, about our culture, about our literature, about anthropology, about a whole host of things, and then knowing them all becomes quite a task, especially for those who are busy building a career and getting to be ready to handle a very complex life ahead. This comes as yet another layer of burden sometimes. But ignorance about these facts also burdens you with a whole host of blanks in the mind where you can't answer the questions that are thrown up. So it's hardly a choice not to know. It is hardly a choice not to engage in debate. It is hardly a choice not to go seek out the truth, no matter how little the time and no matter how much to accomplish in that little time. So I will try and attempt, in course of the next 1 hour, to fill up some of the blanks about Kashmir and Kashmiri Hindus in the context of where we are today. So let me start at the very beginning. And I feel there's no more telling way of pointing this out than the fact that when Punjab was not Punjab, when Bengal was not Bengal, when Maharashtra was not Maharashtra, when Karnataka was not Karnataka, when Andhra was not Andhra, when Kerala was not Kerala, Kashmir was Kashmir. We as Kashmiri Hindus use an almanac, what in Sanskrit is called Panchang, of which 5,093rd year is running. So it is that time in continuity. Every year we publish that year's almanac. In Kashmiri we call it Jantri, It is about the dates, the key festivals, the key observations, the key rituals that we all need to go through, the specific time and day of that. And it is part of our elaborate timekeeping, what in Sanskrit is called Kala Ganana, which a whole host of communities across the country do in their respective geographies, following their own respective Panchang. Some call it Vikrami Samvat, some call it Shak Samvat, we call it Saptarishi Samvat. That old is the tradition, going just by the number that this Jantri, this year's Jantri carries. Scratch a little, and I'm told there is actually a Puran about us. It's called Neelmat Puran. This Neelmat Puran starts with a conversation. And this conversation is between Raja Janamejaya and Rishi Vaishampayan. To tell you who Raja Janamejaya was, he was the great grandson of Arjuna. He was the grandson of Abhimanyu. He was the son of Parikshit. That is who Raja Janamejaya was. And who was Vaishampayan? Vaishampayan was the son and the foremost disciple of Veda Vyasa, who wrote Mahabharata. So Raja Janamejaya asks Rishi Vaishampayan, in Mahabharata, armies from across the country came to fight. And to fight for the truth, for the dharma as they saw it, as their kings saw it. But why didn't the army of Kashmir come to fight in Mahabharata? So those who say Kashmir was never part of Bharat should know that Kashmir figured in the context of Mahabharata also, where the armies were expected, but both Pandavas and Kauravas decided not to call the army. And what was the reason? So Rishi Vaishampayan says the reason was that the king of Kashmir was a juvenile, was not adult. And our morality of war dictates that juveniles do not take part in war because they don't know better. They don't have the judgment to choose the right side to pick for the battle. You know, the tradition was in Mahabharata, both Pandavas and Kauravas had to invite, and the invited king would decide whether he would fight for Kauravas or for Pandavas. Those who believe in democratic spirit and freedom to choose can appreciate this fact and would also know that then, 5 millennia ago, the kind of morality in even war prevailed in that society, in that value system. So the next question obviously was that how was this king juvenile? What happened? And he says, and there is an interesting story, he says when Krishna slayed Kansa, Jarasandh, who was then one of the relatives of Kansa, also of Krishna, because Krishna and Kansa were related, he didn't approve of this slaying and he invited the king of Kashmir, Gonanda, to avenge the killing of Kansa. So Gonanda came and when he challenged Krishna to a duel, Balarama came in between and he said, well, you have to defeat me before you get to my brother. And in that duel, Balarama slayed Gonanda, the king of Kashmir. Gonanda didn't have a son, so his brother, Damodara, ascended the throne. Years later, when Krishna was going to Gandhar for a swayamvar to marry Satyabhama, Gandhar Kashmir was considered one janapada at that time. And he had to go through that territory Damodara remembered that my brother was slain by his brother, and I have an opportunity to challenge Krishna and avenge the killing of my brother. So he challenges Shri Krishna, and Shri Krishna slays Damodara in a duel. Now the entire Yadukul tells Krishna that, listen, he has also died without an heir, so why don't we merge the two kingdoms? And Krishna said, no, that is not the morality of statecraft. The kingdom belongs to the right heir. He says, but he has no heir. Krishna says, yes, he has an heir, but he is in the womb of his wife Yashomati. So what do? He goes to Kashmir and coronates Yashomati as the regent, as the queen ruler. Arguably, she was the first woman ruler king of the world. She was in Kashmir and coronated by none other than Krishna himself. So when Mahabharata happened, her son was born. Her son was named Gonanda too. He was still a juvenile, and both Pandavas and Kauravas decided not to invite him to war. So that is the story of Kashmir. Kashmir, which has not undergone any distortion in name over several millennia. In Sanskrit, the word Kashmir, the literal meaning of Kashmir is saffron. That's where the word kesar is derived from. And when you, in a conversation, say give him a little bit of Kashmir, means give him a little bit of saffron. It's the other way around. The people are asking for Kashmir in a different sense. Otherwise, there wasn't much of a problem. So that's a small legend about Kashmir, as old as that. There's another legend that Kashi, which was perhaps the seat of learning in civilizational India for several millennia, even there the students, when they graduated from their learning as part of their convocation in the ritual, they would walk a few steps in the direction of Kashmir after convocation. And this was symbolic that hereafter I go for higher learning to Kashmir. Even the students in Kashi used to go through this ritual. That posits Kashmir in yet another context as a seat of learning, which is why it was called Sharada Pradesh. In fact, there is a prayer, Namastute Ma Sharade Kashmir Pura Vasini. That Sharada, please bless me, who lives in Kashmir, the goddess of learning. And there was Sharada Peet. And it was the same Sharada Peet where Shankaracharya, Adi Shankara, went and came back as Shankaracharya. That the southern gates of Sharada Peet were first time opened for him. He ascended the peet, and his intellect was acknowledged and approved by his peers there as outstanding, perhaps better than theirs. So that was Sharada Peet, and that is the place called Kashmir. Lot of Sanskrit philosophers and students of Sanskrit, acharyas of Sanskrit would know, if the literature that originated from Kashmir, the Sanskrit literature that originated from Kashmir, were to be taken out of the entire body of Sanskrit literature, you'll be bereft of some of the best works, and probably half of it will go away. And I'll give you an example. There are four Vedas, you know. And if you have to classify another work in Sanskrit as fifth Veda or Veda equivalent, there is a consensus that Bharat Muni's Natya Shastra would qualify to be the fifth Veda. And if you need to understand it, know it, learn about it well. There is a treatise on that Veda. It is called Abhinav Bharati, written by Abhinav Gupta. Without Abhinav Bharati, understanding or learning about Bharat Muni's Natya Shastra is considered virtually impossible or extremely difficult. So, they consider Abhinav Bharati more important a work than Bharat Muni's Natya Shastra itself. And that Abhinav Bharati is one of the middling works of Abhinav Gupta, who did almost 46 major works attributed to him. And one of the most important of those is Tantra Loka, which is the essence of Kashmir Shaivism, the philosophical underpinnings of Kashmiri philosophical traditions. He wrote Abhinav Gita, his treatise on Bhagavad Gita, which again is considered outstanding. He wrote on grammar. He was one of the greatest aestheticians. More than 80 universities across the world, none in India, across the world, teach Abhinav Gupta today. Abhinav Gupta is considered the previous millennia's foremost intellectual the land produced. The first millennia, which is the millennia of the Christ, first 1000 years, Shankaracharya, Adi Shankara, is considered perhaps the foremost intellectual. The next millennia, we are in the third millennia now, Abhinav Gupta is arguably, or perhaps without argument, the foremost intellectual. He came from Kashmir. Sharangadev, who's considered to be the father of Indian music tradition, both Hindustani classical and Carnatic classical. When he was told, asked who, where he's from, his answer was, Asti Swasti Graham Kulavansham Srimad Kashmira Sambhavam. He mentions Kashmir as Srimad Kashmir, giving it such reverence. That's how he introduces himself. That's what Kashmir gave you besides Abhinav Gupta. It gave you Bhatta Lolata, it gave you Ruyaka, it gave you Kayata, it gave you Kshemendra, it gave you Avanti Varmana. It gave you such pantheon of Sanskrit philosophers in every walk of life that if you take them out of the body of Sanskrit literature, what will be left is anybody's speculation. So I am positing Kashmir in our collective consciousness, where it was the fountainhead of path-breaking thinking. It was in Kashmir where Mahayana Buddhism was born and then went to Tibet, and from Tibet to Far East, which is China, Korea and Japan, what you also call Vajrayana. And Kumarajiva took it there. Padma Sambhava took it there, and they were Kashmiris. The second international Buddhist conference that lasted 6 months was hosted in Kashmir, which debated the treatises of Buddhism, the essential questions of life that every philosophy seeks to answer as to who we are, where have we come from, where are we headed, why are we here. These questions engaged the philosophers of Kashmir. Then, when the world was still living in caves, when they were still hunter-gatherers, Kashmir was the beacon of learning, of inquiry, that attracted people from across the globe. It is this civilization that the current noise, current debate, seeks to not only overlook, but hide, distort, deny, disown. And the kind of studies and syllabuses we go through, I feel I have been deprived of this as I grew up. This is not something that my textbooks told me, that my school and college told me, that my teachers told me. No, sorry. It was my inquiry in the last, my parents didn't tell me because they didn't go through this. I thank those who've dragged this issue to a argument, because that led me to an inquiry. I went around looking for people to find out who we were, where are we from. And this is just about scratching the surface. I don't know how many of you have been students of history or have had interest in history. Has any of you heard of a king called Lalitaditya? Please raise hands. Lalitaditya? Two hands. Two hands in an auditorium of at least 200 people right now. But I'm impressed, sir. Lalitaditya has been a well-kept secret. I've heard of Ashoka the Great, I've heard of Akbar the Great, and Lalitaditya's empire was both these empires put together. And he ruled from Kashmir, that was his capital. In northwest, it went up to the Caspian Sea. In south, it came right up to the Kaveri Basin. In east, it went to Pragjyotish, which is Kamrup, which is Assam. And it coexisted when the Rashtrakutas were ruling Gujarat and Maharashtra. Kannauj emperor used to send obeisance to him. More important, he ruled when Islam was spreading like a frenzy across Central Asia. And you don't talk about him. Your history books have completely erased him. Not just him, his entire dynasty, which is Karakota dynasty. In 7th century, 8th, in between, cusp, it was 699 to 750. So I wonder, what are we doing to ourselves? And how little we know about ourselves, and we are seeking to decide a few questions which are of far-reaching implication. In what ignorance? Kalhana, the first ever recorded history anywhere in the world of any place, is from Kalhana about Kashmir. Rajtarangini. In Sanskrit, the word means literally Raja is kings and Tarangini is the river. So the river of kings, the way time flowed. And this Rajtarangini, once he finished his own first ever between 949 and 951, he started from the first king, Neel, who was the son of Rishi Kashyapa, who retrieved Kashmir from a huge reservoir of water called Satisara. And there is again an elaborate story about that in Neel Mata Puran. But I'm not going to keep you engaged in prehistoric texts and prehistoric issues. It is only to contextualize as to where do you decide the time should start for you to know what Kashmir is or has been about. You can go as far as that. But Rajtaranginis were written after Kalhan also. Zonaraj was another who, it was almost like a relay race. Where Kalhan left is where Zonaraj picked up. Where Zonaraj left is where Shrivar picked up. where Shrivar left, another one picked up and it went on till 17th century. And it tells you what Kashmir has been through in the medieval period also. Islam came to Kashmir in 1339. As in, the first king ascended the throne in 1339, the first Muslim king. He did not come riding a horse winning a war, no. He had come good 20-25 years earlier. He was given a refuge by the then king Udayandeva. This king came from Swat. Have you heard of the word Swat? A valley in northwest frontier province of Pakistan, 100 kilometers as the crow flies from Kashmir Valley. Part of the Kashmir Janapada, as was then called, from the state Mahabharata. Swat, incidentally, is the place where Panini was born. Panini, does the name ring a bell? The father of grammar, Ashtadhyayi, which today also perhaps is the most scientific work on linguistics. That's the land Swat. And who is it known for now? Mullah Radio, Fazlullah, Tehreek-e-Taliban, Pakistan. From that Swat came this noble renegade prince called Shah Mir, because he tried staging a coup there and he failed and he ran for his life, took refuge in this kingdom, and Udayandev, could have been any Indian king, gave him refuge because he was from the nobility, from the ruling family. He also gave him a place in his council of ministers, probably also gave him some land, some endowments. I can speculate, he must have felt that, you know, there is Islam that has reached Swat and they could well be hostile kings there, so it might help to keep someone from that region to know better on your side. By 1339, there were such circumstances that this king was deposed. With the consensus of the nobility, Shah Mir ascended the throne. And he ascended the throne with Raj Tilak and Mantruchar. With all Vedic, Shaiv, traditional ways of ascension. He came up. With him started the Shamsuddin dynasty that lasted 222 years and 25 kings. And once he was in, and he had someone called over, his spiritual master called Bulbul Shah, who insisted that there should be proselytization. Only then he can feel safe. He should consolidate his power by winning people over, by converting them to his faith. And when king starts professing of faith, it's very easy to win converts. They started winning converts. But it wasn't that easy either. For next 100 years, till 1450, Sanskrit remained the court language. Till 1450, successive generations of kings ascended the throne with Raj Tilak and Mantruchar. Because it was necessary to keep the elite, the noble, the influential people of the society with you. In 1450, the one king who replaced Sanskrit eventually with Persian was the king called Zainul Abidin. We call him Badshah, the great king. We call him Badshah, the great king, because he was not as tyrant as his father. His father was called Sikandar Sultan, with a sobriquet, the Butshikan, the iconoclast. He earned his reputation demolishing temples and demolishing these statuettes in those temples. He's the one who unleashed an extremely barbaric, bloody conversion drive in Kashmir that drove Kashmiri Hindus out. That was the first exodus of Kashmiri Hindus. I don't know how many of you visited Kashmir or Anantnag or a place called Mutton, which was originally Martand, from where it has distorted into the name Mutton, M-A-T-T-A-N. It has one of the most magnificent ruins of the Sun Temple there. I don't know if you've seen a film called, what is that film? The Last Song has this Sun Temple in Heather. Yes. That temple is Martand Sun Temple. India has 4 Sun Temples. One of them survives in Konark. The other 3 don't. They are in ruins. Another magnificent Sun Temple was in Multan, now in Pakistan. One is in Motera in Gujarat. And this one. Sikandar did not have gunpowder and he wanted to demolish it. It is a huge temple with massive stone boulders. Try as he may, he could not demolish it. So what did he do? He dug trenches around it, burnt acres of forest of the surrounding areas, piled up the wood there, burnt it, which burnt for months, some say 6 to 8 months. Still, those boulders cracked up but did not fall. And then he gave up. You have to just go there, look at it, shut your eyes and imagine the grandeur of what it must have been. It won't be difficult for you to realize. And that's what Kashmir has been through. This Sun Temple was built by Lalitaditya. Srinagar was built by Ashok 2,200 years ago. The name Srinagar hasn't changed, the name Kashmir hasn't changed. There wasn't much of a treasure to be looted from that temple. It was sheer, I don't know, jealousy or sadism that you could not bear to look at such a magnificent structure which you couldn't call your own. So it must be destroyed. That is what happened to the capital of the Krishna Devaraya Empire at Hampi. I don't know how many of you have seen that city. When Naipaul reached there in mid-60s, and Naipaul was a third generation Caribbean of Indian parents. He just came to look at the land of his forefathers, third generation, maybe fourth. And he says, he writes, that when I stood there in front of Hampi ruins, I cried. As to what kind of mindset could this be that goes out to rapaciously destroy a work of art? Magnificence or excellence of human endeavor carved in stone, in architecture, in planning. And from that cathartic crying emerged the literature which got him Nobel Prize, novels like, works like A Wounded Civilization, An Area of Darkness, Among the Believers. That's what he wrote. He went to Indonesia, he went to various other societies, he went to Egypt to see how faith colonialism, which preceded the economic colonialism of Europe, the kind of havoc it wreaked to societies, to civilizations, to cultures, to indigenous people across the world. And it all happened in Kashmir. Now, a lot of contemporary Kashmiri society intellectuals are in denial. They don't wish to accept it. When you quote Raj Tarangini, by Zone Raj, by Shrivar. Now Zone Raj, Raj Tarangini was written at the time of Zainul Abideen. He paid for it. It was on his scholarship. His own historian is writing about what has happened and what is happening. Because it was truth, it couldn't be objected to, it couldn't be denied. And he wrote this. Shrivar writes what happened later and how the indigenous people who refused to convert were chased, were killed, were massacred, were hounded out time and again. So I say, okay, you dismiss this as exaggeration of Hindu historians who wrote in Sanskrit. A living Kashmiri scholar called Dr. Kashinath Pandita in his 80s, he spent more than 20 years in Tehran University teaching in the 70s and 80s. He went there as a student and then he was employed by the university there to teach. He picked Persian. He is one of the best known Persian scholars, and his time spent in Iran, he went to their archives. And he stumbled upon two works in Persian, Tawfatul Ahbab and Baharistan-e-Shahi. And he translates those works because those works are about Kashmir. It is about a detailed account of missionaries in Kashmir, what they did to it when they came from Iran. Don't believe me. Just read those works. It is gut-wrenching. It tells about one particular missionary called Shamsuddin Araki. Not Iraqi, Araki. A-R-A-Q-I. He was a Shia missionary. He goes from village to village converting people, and they convert. Because he comes with a lashkar, and then he moves on. And then later, a few months later, when he comes there again, he finds them back to their old ways. He's very distraught. He tries finding out, and they tell him, these are very clever, very wicked people. They just, as soon as you move on, they go back. He says, why? How? Say, A, the women in their families are at the core of their life. So when you come, they hide, they sit on their own books, they hide them right underneath. So when you make them come out and you go search for everything in the house and you destroy whatever you think is part of their spiritual, religious, ritual practice, it is these books that they go back to and sustain. This is okay. What else? What is it that becomes, that makes their transition from their faith to Islam irreversible? Can you please find that out? And he's told, well, all sins can be forgiven in their faith except one, for which there is no penance, there is no repentance, and you are consigned to multiple lives of sin and punishment. And what is that sin? That sin is eating beef. There is no penance for that. Ah, great. So next time he goes to a village, and it is written down meticulously, he summons all the families. They all come there. Then he gets them to bring their cows. They're brought there. He asked the men folk to slaughter those cows. They are slaughtered, forced to slaughter their cows in front of them. Then he asks the women to cook and to create a feast and eat with them. And he does this village after village, habitat after habitat. and his historians, with great pride, meticulously record it. They write about the resistance offered by the priests of the temples which were laid siege to. Says these idiots just won't understand. We are bringing light to them, we are bringing knowledge to them, we are bringing emancipation to them, and they keep fighting and dying. And about one Vishnu Swamin temple, he says, the priest went up to the Shikhar when he felt that his defenses were crumbling and there was no longer possible to save the temple. He leaps from the top Shikhar and commits suicide. He says, what an idiot. This is Taufatul Ahbab. The best thing is, these incidents are verbatim reflecting in Raj Tarangini. Raj Tarangini and Taufatul Ahbab are mirror images, literally, for various incidents. So what do? You dismiss Raj Tarangini as an exaggerated Hindu pathos, and you dismiss Taufatul Ahbab as an exaggerated Islamic bravado. But you are not willing to accept the truth. And I'm talking about my blood brothers, people of my ethnicity, my language, my region, my culture, my soil. So when I realized about 7-8 years back that all of us have been moved, made to flee for their lives, and have to now raise children outside Kashmir without the facility for language, without the facility for the same lifestyle, rituals, culture, food, clothes, neighborhood, whatever gives you an identity. You see, if you lose your language, for example, it is one of the most important markers of your identity. What are you left with? If you lose your food habit, if you lose your clothing, if you lose your community celebrations, festivals, you get assimilated in the neighborhoods where you are scattered around India and across the world. You become a namesake Kashmiri. Perhaps your nose, your skin color, over a period of time, that also will give way, but that's what remains. So I thought, let me start documenting it, and we started publishing in Roots in Kashmir, a journal called Prajnat. We called it of Kashmiri culture and identity, a documentation. We thought, we need to preserve it if someday, somewhere, somebody feels the pangs to know who we are, how we were, what we did, where have we come from, how did we reach here. There should be a ready reckoner. So in that, I once wrote about Sharada Peeth. And I spoke to someone who I knew had gone to Sharada Peeth. His name was Professor Nazki. Professor Farooq Nazki. His some friends or relatives lived in Muzaffarabad, Kashmir. He had gone there to attend a wedding. And he said, I decided to go to Sharada. And in the introduction of his travelogue, he says, I am the 14th generation descendant of Ganesh Dutt Kaul, who lived near the hillock of Hari Parvat and was the custodian of Sharika Mandir. I am his 14th generation descendant. I don't know what has come upon me. I don't know what is pulling me. It is taking me to Sharada. And he walks. And he reaches there. And he talks about its magnificence, and he talks about how these 14 generations have lived since. He clicks pictures, and I publish that travelogue. And I'll for my life be indebted to him, because we can't go there. I can't go there. I'll never get the visa. But he went, and through his eyes, ears, and experiences. But there are very few such people who are willing to acknowledge their ancestry, and not just acknowledge, admit to it, celebrate it, go into print and suffer for it. His family has to live in Jammu. He cannot live in Kashmir anymore. He teaches in an agricultural college. That is what you've done to this Kashmir. There is another person, Meem Zafar Hai. Meem Zafar Hai chose to learn Sanskrit, chose to learn about Abhinav Gupta. He was so moved. When I met him, I said, "What made you learn this?" He said, "Do you think Abhinav Gupta is only yours? Abhinav Gupta is mine too." I thought it was a little rhetorical. But then I came to know he had named his son Abhinava. I only hope that this realization only grows, because knowledge, the Prophet himself said, is not of one persuasion, one ritual, one faith, one religion, one geography. Knowledge is universal. The word Hindu doesn't come even once in Bhagavad Gita or in Mahabharata or in Vedas, incidentally. Not once. But unfortunately, we are faced with an extremely narrow, blinkered, and aggressive espousal of an identity which even the word sectarian actually dignifies. Because what is happening in the world across, I mean, there is no Bajrang Dal in Syria where ISIS is slaughtering Shias. There is no Vishwa Hindu Parishad in Pakistan where Ahmadiyyas have been declared non-Muslims, and the first Muslim Nobel scientist, his grave tombstone was erased. The word Muslim was erased from his tombstone. That, never mind that it created a stupid, a very hilarious kind of sentence when they erased the word. The introduction was the first Muslim Nobel laureate for science. They erased the Muslim and it said the first Nobel laureate for science, which is obviously wrong. So that's the mindset. And the mindset is that the hill Shankaracharya in the middle of Srinagar city is now named Takht-e-Suleiman. The hill that has Sharika temple, to which Dr. Farooq Nazki claimed that his ancestor in 14 generations ago was the caretaker, has been named Koh-e-Mahran. The temple where I mentioned about the Panchang, the Saptarishi Samvat, where all the Jyotishis of our community used to gather on the Varsh Pratipada, which is the first day of the year, to compare their Panchangs with each other. That place was called Vicharnag because they would exchange ideas and fine-tune their time calculations in order to arrive at an almanac which was with consensus. That Vicharnag is named Firdaus. The place which was Gaukadal connected Ganpatyar with another locality called Mysoma in the middle of Srinagar. Mysoma, incidentally, is called Gaza Strip because this Gandhian with guns called Yasin Malik lives there. That bridge is called Gaukadal. It has been renamed Madina Chowk. And lo and behold, Srinagar is referred to now as Sheher-e-Khas. In conversations, in writings, in mails. So what are we trying to do? What has come upon us? And in this context, you have to understand, what is this Azadi? I ask, what is about Indian constitution that you hate? Tell us, we will replace it for our common good. We will move the parliament to amend that law. After all, there have been 100 amendments to the constitution. No, sir, no suggestion. What is your demand that will make you more free, will liberate you? No, sir, no demand. Azadi ka matlab kya? La ilaha illallah. Pakistan se rishta kya? La ilaha illallah. This is the content of this agitation. Must do the content analysis. Kashmir was never part of India. That's what they say. Try engaging them in a debate. Have you studied history? Where are you saying this from? Illiterate school dropouts make these assertions. What do you do? Indian constitution is to a fault most liberal, most permissive document where from Article 25 to 30 actually deprive the majority population of privileges that are given only to minorities. That's why I say to a fault. No, sir. We don't want to live under Indian constitution. Fine, but you already have your own constitution. Incidentally, Kashmir has its own constitution. I hope some of you know this. That constitution was given to Kashmir by its own constituent assembly in 1956, good 6 years after India gave itself a constitution. Now, 6 years later, I thought they had an opportunity to improve upon Indian constitution, add some more features in order to make it even more desirable. But what did they do? There is no mention of fundamental rights in Kashmir constitution. None. There is no mention of the word minority in the constitution of Kashmir. So I must tell you, Kashmir Valley today has 99% Muslims. And they are a minority. As per Indian constitution, they get all the benefits. And we, a single digit minority in Kashmir Valley, were majority who were discriminated against and chased out because even that small minority could not be tolerated. And why it couldn't be tolerated? I'll tell you. We, this minority in Kashmir, did not stay in ghettos. We were in every mohalla, every city, every district headquarter, every district, every village of Kashmir. Even if we lived as minority of one household surrounded by scores of non-Muslim households, we lived there. If in some villages, as an exception, we did not exist, we reached there because we were part of either Post and Telegraph, or telephone, or we were school teachers, or we were part of the primary health center. Some reason we had access to the village and the population if we'd not lived there. So we knew every square inch of the valley by the back of our hands, and we were patriots. So if you had to create a movement of secessionism from India, you could not afford to have people who could be considered as eyes and ears of India. So the first thing you had, who knew the language, who knew the terrain, who knew the troublemakers, who knew who was up to what, and therefore could become a great deterrent. So we were killed in a targeted manner. The icons of our society were targeted, killed in marketplaces, thoroughfares, in their homes with impunity. Justice Neel Ganju was killed, a retired man in his 70s. Professor Sarvanand called Premi was killed right in the middle of his brows where he used to make a tilak. This scholar of Sanskrit had translated Quran into Sanskrit. He was a scholar of Persian and Sanskrit both. And he used to keep that copy of translated Quran in Sanskrit at the place of his worship. So he decided not to leave. They came to his house. They said, we have to discuss few things with him. His son said, I will come along. They said, okay, your wish. The family never saw both of them. 3 days later, the bodies were found. And he was shot right here at the forehead where he wore his tilak, Chandan tilak. Lasakol, Hridayanath Vanchu, Balkrishan Ganju, Pandit Tiklal Taplu. The list is endless. And when this happened, we were extremely terrified. I don't know how many of you have lived as a minority Hindu in an overwhelming non-Hindu community or society. I don't know. We have, and for generations. When I said first Sultan came in 1339 and his dynasty lasted 222 years, it was followed by another dynasty called Chak dynasty, followed by another dynasty called Mughals, followed by another dynasty called Pathan, till in 1819 we were up to our gills. One of my ancestors, Birbal Dhar, went to Maharaja Ranjit Singh in Lahore, said, please liberate us from Pathans. He got the army. Maharaja Ranjit Singh said, what if it is a trap and you get my people killed? He says, okay, keep my son as a guarantee. Slaughter him if it turns out to be a trap. Goes back, gets the Kashmir liberated. So 1819, this community began to breathe a little. 1947, we were handed over back to Sheikh Abdullah, who started the entire process all over again. Why did we do this? I must share this small part of history to you. This is modern history. Am I taking too long? Do I have some more time? May I? Thanks. In mid-40s of the previous century, we were on the verge of partition. At that time, British India, which was directly ruled under the crown, decided to partition us according to the majority population provinces. So one Mr. Radcliffe came and he drew a Radcliffe line, and that created Pakistan on our western, on eastern borders. But there was another entity besides British India, and this was the princely India. 565 princely states. So what do we do with them? Congress said, why don't we have a referendum in these places and let the population decide? Jinnah said, no, not possible. He said, why? Lawyer that he was, he said, who is the sovereign in British India? The viceroy said, the crown. He says, fine. So crown, has crown done any referendum in India as to which parts want to go to Pakistan or which parts want to go to India? No. You have in your own wisdom decided to draw a line called Radcliffe line. He says, fine. So who's the sovereign in these princely states? He says, those princes and the kings. So let them decide. Why are you imposing your democracy on them? Congress wanted to get over with the task of partition. They said, okay, sir, as you wish. Now, this was not such a technical issue. The politics behind this was, in these princely states, you had a number of states where population was Hindu, but but the ruler was Muslim. If you conducted a referendum, they would straight away opt for India, was the common sense. So what do? You vest the right in the king who was Muslim, who you were propping up, and who was expected to side with Pakistan. The only exception to this rule was Kashmir. So why is Jinnah willing to gamble on Kashmir and let the Hindu king of Kashmir decide on a majority Muslim population of Jammu and Kashmir? He had good reason. One, he knew Kashmir was contiguous to the incoming, forthcoming state of Pakistan. So it was easy to manage Kashmir than, let's say, manage Hyderabad Nizam or Junagadh or Bhopal, which were far away from Pakistan. So he needed kings and princes empowered in these riyasats and kingdoms. But in Kashmir, he was fairly comfortable. And another reason besides the contiguity, the geographical nearness, was the land routes to Kashmir went through the incoming state of Pakistan. The land route to Srinagar went through Muzaffarabad, Uri area. The land route to Jammu Punch went through Akhnoor, that bridge. So there was no land connectivity with the India as would have emerged post-partition. From Pathankot, which was in Gurdaspur, which was in Punjab, had a kaccha road to Jammu. And from Jammu to Srinagar, there was a kaccha road where that too went through Banihal Pass, which was clogged for 6 months in a year because of snow. So there was no way India had access to Kashmir. And all the access was through Pakistan. So he thought that he had Pakistan by its neck to control it. So he gambled on it. And of course, Nizam of Hyderabad, Nawab of Junagadh, Nawab of Bhopal did throw their tantrums, and it was the sagacity of Patel and Nehru combined that they saw through the integration of India as we see it today. In Kashmir, Nehru had a hatred for Raja. He was great friends with Sheikh. Sheikh Abdullah had emerged in his own right a leader of the Muslim community in Valley. When Jinnah went to Srinagar, Sheikh tried asserting his political clout over Kashmir population. Jinnah was extremely adamant and arrogant as one and only leader of the subcontinental Muslims. So when Sheikh decided to, you know, express terms, etc., he said, "Don't talk to me, we'll talk after partition's done." Sheikh knew how Punjabi Muslims had dealt with Kashmiri Muslims in Lahore. In winters, a lot of Kashmiris used to come down to the plains to work as head loaders, to work as manual labor. They were illiterate, unlettered, unskilled, very often exploited, and not just exploited, but humiliated. That boorish, aggressive Punjabi Musliman who today lords over Baluchs and Sindhs and Pathans would treat Kashmiris even worse than these three. So he knew this, and he knew that a small population in Kashmir, which wasn't even 20-25 lakhs at that time, will be completely absorbed in the millions that existed in Pakistan. He was proved right. The way this Punjabi Muslim dominated polity dealt with Bengali Muslims and alienated them in no time, Kashmiri Muslims would have been chicken feed. And he thought that, and he was ambitious, so he felt a little wary. Friendship with Nehru gave him probably the assurance that he has better luck in India. Maharaja, because Nehru was not paying much attention to him, in fact humiliating him, forced him to be ambivalent. Maharaja said, "I need time to decide." So he signed a standstill agreement with Pakistan, with India. Meanwhile, India was sorting out Nizam, sorting out Junagadh. That made Jinnah desperate. So despite signing a standstill agreement, first he blockaded Kashmir. The essential commodities to Kashmir, like kerosene, even salt and oil, were blockaded because land routes were through Pakistan. When even that didn't work, he got tribals along with his own army in Mufti to raid Kashmir. That is what made up Maharaja's mind. He signed an accession document with India. India lifted its soldiers and rolled back the invasion. Rest is history, as they say. But the same document of accession that other 565 rulers signed with India was suddenly, 2 years later, vested with lot more layers of privileges. The same Congress party, the same incoming interim government, who swore about building a secular democratic polity in across India, decided to make concessions to Kashmir because Kashmir, being a Muslim majority, had decided to come to India as some kind of a blackmail ransom to Sheikh Abdullah. Listen, I delivered Kashmir to you. Now, what is in it for me? And you literally reverse the entire process when it comes to Kashmir. You give Article 370, which gives privileges to Kashmir that are not available to any other place in the country. You circumcise the jurisdiction of Indian Parliament, which has jurisdiction over every square inch of land called India, but it doesn't have jurisdiction in Kashmir. And when did this Article 370 come? It came in November 1949 when Constitution was being finalized, not on 26th of October 1947 when the document of accession was signed. And what did Dr. Ambedkar say about this? Sheikh Abdullah comes, so he started whining to Nehru, and Nehru says, okay, please go to Bhimrao Ambedkar, he's chairman of the drafting committee, please tell him that I want a special status and 370 should be incorporated. So Dr. Ambedkar said, you want me to be traitor to the cause of India, a newly born republic, independent state of India? You want me to backstab this country by giving them privileges which are not available to anybody else? So he decided not to draft this. At that time, Nehru then told Sheikh Abdullah to go to another gentleman. His name was Gopalswamy Iyengar. Gopalswamy Iyengar used to be the Prime Minister of Maharaja of Jammu and Kashmir. He's a civil servant, a bureaucrat. Gopalswamy Iyengar failed to persuade the Congress Working Committee and the Constituent Assembly. Then Nehru persuaded Patel to see this through because I want to see this through. And Patel reluctantly persuaded the Constituent Assembly to at least see this through with a prefix called temporary and transient as a concession. Dr. Ambedkar refused to do that also, and he said, if you insist on doing this, I walk out from Constituent Assembly. So when Article 370 was passed, it was in absentia of Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar. I must salute that man and his sense of propriety, that he said, I refuse to be part of that Constituent Assembly that passes Article 370. When every other statesman and loyal nationalist was committing this crime against India, it was Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar who refused to be a party to this decision and walked out. That's how Article 370 came into being. And later, Article 35A was smuggled into constitution without even any reference to parliament or debate. And 35A gave rights to define the citizen in retrospective effect, to deny the right of citizenship to a whole lot of Kashmiris. And that's how these distortions came about. And when you start giving privileges, when you start making exceptions for one set of citizens as opposed to other, you, where will you stop cannot be defined. And today, what started off as a movement for privileges distorts itself into a movement for secession, further distorts itself into movement for freedom, further distorts into itself into a movement for caliphate. It is only a changing degree from privileges to secessionism to complete independence to caliphate. They say now we don't even need nationhood. It's Islamic Ummah. It's not Pakistan. Where will it end beyond ISIS? I cannot speculate. I don't know where Baghdadi will take it to the next stage, but so far I can see only this stage. And next stage is possible only if the world survives. I don't know, the world can survive the current stage. The caliphate wants to take the world to. This is the challenge we as a nation face, nation which is yet to be 70 years old post 47. We as a civilization face, which in Kashmir itself is more than 5,000 years old. We as a society face, who have multiple languages, multiple faiths, multiple lifestyles. I give you just an example. Yemen, which is the easternmost end of the Islamic arc, speaks Arabic, and in its westernmost end in Morocco, speaks Arabic. Between these two, not one single language survives. Whereas, in India, they still say, kos kos pe pani badle saat kos pe bani. The dialect changes every few kilometers. Sorry, the taste of water changes every few kilometers, and the dialect changes a few more kilometers. That is the kind of variety, that is the kind of plurality, that is the kind of spectrum we in our society have. And in the Arabic speaking world, from Yemen to Morocco, you don't have even one language surviving. In Egypt, their indigenous language survives only in the scriptures of Coptic church that predated Islam. Egyptians were never Arabic. They were North Africans, but they speak Arabic. Libyans speak Arabic. Tunisians speak Arabic. Moroccans speak Arabic. That's the monochromatic society you're trying to build. There was a scholar in Saudi Arabia who was recently astounded. He said, India has so many languages, so many religions, so many practices, and it is so quiet. Saudi Arabia, we have one religion, one language, and so much of violence. Is there something we can learn? In Arabian Peninsula today, air forces have taken to skies and they bomb. Just Google the latest pictures from Yemen. It looks like Ethiopia and Eritrea of 90s, with children and flies all over their faces. And these are one of the richest places on earth. There's no dearth of money. There's no dearth of riches. There's no dearth of uniformity. There's no other religion. There are no other religious places. There's no linguistic distinction. There's no lifestyle distinction. What are you fighting for? Look at Aleppo. Look at Damascus. What are you fighting over? And what are you trying to convert Kashmir into? And why? For what reason? I can't keep going on and on and on. I rest my case. I'm ready to answer questions if I can answer them. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Now the floor is open for questions. Our volunteers will be with their mics. So if anyone wants to ask a question, raise your hands and they'll be there.
Good evening, sir. Excuse me, sir. I came a bit late, you know. But anyway, I will ask what I want to ask.
Please.
First thing is, I'm basically Hindu. I'm an Indian. I want pro Kashmiri. But impartially, if you talk, in any conversation in TV, why our people, particularly Indians, you know? I'm a pro-Indian only. But they talk violently with Pakistanis. They won't allow them to talk. What is this? If so impartial, why can't allow? That's one thing. And second thing, you can be friendly, you know. You can be friendly, let them express their views. And even if you take the case of Ashutosh Goswami, you know. So always, you know, he will try to suppress. He will try to suppress Pakistanis' voices. There will be two or three people representatives, but he will never allow them to talk. That's one thing. And second thing is, second thing I just want to see, recently, 1 or 2 years back, in Great Britain, that is Ireland and Great Britain to be integrated, there was a plebiscite. With the plebiscite only, they have decided and whether to separate out Ireland from Great Britain or not. But why our people are not, okay, whether they agree for a plebiscite or not, at least they can talk, no? Why our people are not allowing to talk? I'm telling you impartially, I'm an Indian.
Can you hear me? Am I audible? Can you? Okay. Am I allowed to keep sitting while talking? No. Thank you. So you're asking the wrong person. You must invite Arnab to the campus. I can probably hazard a guess as to why he does this. I'm not justifying it. How I understand it is, he is doing to Pakistanis on his show what he wants India to do to Pakistan at the border. And since that was not happening, So, since that was not happening, it was a poor substitute for it. I'm being slightly facetious. He's extremely sensitive to his program being abused by people with the wrong kind of propaganda. So, what he does is, when he asks a question, if he knows this opportunity to answer his question is going to be misused into saying something else as opposed to answering the question specifically, then he interrupts, because he doesn't want to be turned into a fool by a guest who's hostile and who would use this opportunity of a platform to do his propaganda instead of answering his questions. That's where he comes from.
to a more substantive question that you asked, why not go for a plebiscite? If Scotland could, you know, go for a referendum and decide whether they want to stay with United Kingdom or not, why shouldn't we go for a plebiscite here? I would like to know, how often should one go for a plebiscite? What is the frequency you recommend? And on what issues? Suppose Adolf Hitler had conducted a referendum in Germany whether Jews should be put into the furnaces and boilers, and he had got a positive vote, do you think that would have justified the Holocaust of Jews? Do you think a majoritarian vote can decide whether jihad can slaughter you or not? I'm asking you. So Kashmir, local area, majority decides that the minority should be exterminated. Will that positive vote justify their extermination? Is this referendum about rule of law? I'm asking you. There was a rule of law, there was a constituent assembly that gave itself a constitution which is different from India. I must tell you, this state has a flag which is different from India. They have a constitution which is different from India. Parliament of India cannot make laws about Jammu and Kashmir. I hope you are aware of that. Right to information, which is your fundamental right, was not in the constitution of Jammu and Kashmir. Right to live, right to practice one's own faith as fundamental rights are alien to the constitution of Jammu and Kashmir. This movement is not about self-determination, sir. This movement is about Khilafat, Caliphate, about going back to medieval ages. And I dare say this, even if majority population in Kashmir, which I am sure it is not, even if they want so, it will not be given to them. This country was divided on the basis of faith in 1947. Those who cannot live in this constitution have a border to cross over to.
Next question.
Thank you, sir, for your engagement. My question is direct and simple. What do you think is the role played by not necessarily militant but ideologically very aggressive organizations like Jamaat-e-Islami in the context of Kashmir? Because we have seen this working in Bangladesh. There is a new way of terror being incited. There is a different working strategy in India. So how do you contextualize the role of Jamaat-e-Islam?
See, I'm glad you asked this question. Where I left about the polity in Jammu and Kashmir. So when a democratic polity was introduced in Jammu and Kashmir post its accession, the leading formation in Kashmir was National Conference led by Sheikh Abdullah. The alternative politics practiced by Congress did not have the cadre. The cadre was with National Conference, and National Conference on Sheikh Abdullah's say-so had acceded to India. The small minority pocket which opposed National Conference and Sheikh Abdullah even before accession belonged to Jamaat-e-Islami. Jamaat-e-Islami was opposed to Kashmir's accession of India. They were in a small minority. And they had this small cadre which was spreading religious fervor of the fundamentalist kind. Kashmir Islam is Aitikadi Islam. And when I say Aitikadi Islam, it is closer to the Barelvi strain school of Islam and not Devbandi. In Barelvi school of Islam, let me give you one of the examples. They believe in the concept of Vasila. Vasila is a medium, a go-between, as it were. So they believe that lot of peer, fakir, awliyas, and religious, pious people can act as go-between, intermediaries between Allah and you. This was Aitikadi Islam, and the impact of Shaiv Hindu society on that Islam was immense. For example, in mosques, they used to sing to the praise of Prophet and Allah. It was called Darud Khani. Like we sing aartis and bhajans, they would do Darud Khani. This was typical to the Islam of Kashmir. Jamaat-e-Islami was opposed to it as a minority small party. But they had an alternative cadre to Sheikh Abdullah's National Conference. So parties who wanted to oppose Sheikh Abdullah didn't have a cadre, used this cadre. And this cadre lent its services to these political parties in lieu of benefits, in lieu of concessions, in lieu of legitimacy. So Congress ruling from Delhi, competing with National Conference and Plebiscite Front that became national, that turned into Plebiscite Front from National Conference, and Sheikh Abdullah was deposed, encouraged and cultivated in a give and take relationship with this cadre. Mufti Muhammad Saeed was a Congress politician. PDP survives on Jamaat-e-Islami cadre. And this Jamaat-e-Islami cadre over the last 60 years, three generations, has been allowed so much concession and so much leeway, so many privileges, that it has grown and spread into a big monster. They don't need their madrasas anymore. They have penetrated the government school education system, and today every government school mimics a madrasa. And it breeds fundamentalists. And it is this monster, nurtured and grown over the last six decades with complete involvement of, blessings of our polity, playing hide and seek, playing nudge and wink, who have created this monster. And to answer your question, you are harvesting the seeds you allowed to be sown over the years.
Next question.
Sir, can I ask question in Hindi if you don't mind?
Please, puchiye.
Sir, apne pluralism ki baat ki, diversity ki baat ki, har ek course pe hamara dialectical badal jata hai. Apne aisa kaha. और मैं भी अपने इस देश के डाइवर्सिटी पे, यूनिटी इन डाइवर्सिटी पे गर्व करना चाहूँगा. और मुझे लगता है यहाँ पे बैठा हुआ हर एक आदमी अपने इस देश की डाइवर्सिटी पे गर्व करता होगा. क्वेश्चन पूछ, फोन देने दो थोड़ा. नहीं, क्या सर, इसी बहाने आप क्यों ना उन लोगों को करा तमाचा मारिए जो कहते हैं हमारा देश सिर्फ हिंदी, हिंदू और हिंदू राष्ट्र है. कोई तमिल लैंग्वेज नहीं, कोई तेलुगु नहीं, कोई मलयालम नहीं, कोई कश्मीरी नहीं, कोई गुजराती नहीं, कोई मराठी नहीं, कोई मणिपुरी नहीं. सिर्फ चाहते हैं कि एक ही लैंग्वेज हो हिंदी, सिर्फ चाहते हैं कि एक ही धर्म हो हिंदू. इस बहाने कैमरा भी है और आप बोल भी देंगे, अच्छा लगेगा. और दूसरी बात मैं ये कहना चाहता हूँ कि मैसेज गवर्नमेंट को भी पहुँचा दीजिए कि हमारा प्लूरलिज्म को बचाते हुए. अरे क्वेश्चन तो सुन लेने दो भाई मेरे, अरे क्वेश्चन तो सुन लेने दो, अरे क्वेश्चन 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 गवर्नमेंट को मैसेज पहुंचा दीजिए कि हम कश्मीरी कश्मीर में ही रहेंगे. हम कश्मीरी कश्मीर जाना चाहते हैं. एक अलग बना के नहीं, सब लोग एक साथ रहेंगे, मिलजुल करके रहेंगे. और सर, आपकी आपने कुछ गलतियां की हिस्ट्री में सर. सर आपने कुछ गलतियां की है हिस्ट्री में, तो मैं कुछ पॉइंट्स गिनाना। सर सर एक मिनट मैं बता।
बोलने दीजिए, बोलने।
प्लीज 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 मेंटेन द डेकोरम।
क्या मैं क्वेश्चन पूछूं सर? आप बोलिएगा तब मैं पूछूंगा।
देखिए इन्हें पूछ लेने दीजिए, पूछ लेने।
सर एक क्वेश्चन हो चुका
है, पूछ लेने दीजिए, पूछ लेने दीजिए, आप पूछ लीजिए, पूछ लीजिए।
सर आपने,
लेकिन आप प्रश्न पूछिए।
प्रश्न ही है सर, ये सब प्रश्न ही है।
आप 10 प्रश्न पूछिए, लेकिन प्रश्न पूछिए।
कि जज्बे को यहाँ से सलाम कर दो सर।
मैं कह रहा हूँ आप 10 प्रश्न पूछिए, लेकिन प्रश्न पूछिए।
सर आपने कहा कि कश्मीर में जो महायाना बुद्धिज्म सबसे पहले श्रीलंका भेजा था, और उसके बाद वहां से फिर शुरू हुआ था कि चाइना जाएगा और फिर कोरिया जापान जाएगा, तो ये सेकंड काउंसिल में शुरुआत।
मैं आपको इसकी बात का जवाब दे दूं, यहीं से शुरू करता हूं। जिस बुद्धिज्म की आप बात कर रहे हैं, अशोक ने अपनी बहन संघमित्रा को भेजा था। ओके, मे आई आंसर इन इंग्लिश सर? ओके थैंक यू। The Buddhism that spread from India to Sri Lanka to Burma to Thailand and to Indochina, which is Laos, Vietnam, Kampuchea, this belt, is called Theravada Buddhism or Hinayana Buddhism. Since you are the student of Buddhism, I shouldn't be educating you, but those who are not, for their benefit, I am sharing this. The Buddhism that spread northwards from Kashmir, the second Buddhist international which was hosted in Kashmir was hosted in the reign of Kanishka the king. It wasn't hosted by Ashoka. Fourth council is there, but second, I'm talking about second. So, Mahayana Buddhism or Vajrayana Buddhism originated in Kashmir. I can bet my last penny on this. Nagarjuna, who lived in Andhra, traveled to Kashmir. He was a Vaishnava Brahmin. He converted to Buddhism there. And that is the cradle from where Kumarajiva and Padmasambhava and the other philosopher scholars traveled to first Tibet, then to Central Asia and Far East. And this strain of Buddhism is Mahayana Buddhism and Vajrayana Buddhism. This originated in Kashmir. That is what that's where I need to, I can't go beyond this on this issue. And let me come to the first question that you asked. I'm happy you raised this question of language. Let me share one thing which I missed in my speech with you. When India earned its freedom and gave itself its constitution, the constitution had the 8th schedule in which it identified 14 languages, which eventually over 4 occasions grew to 22 languages as officially recognized languages under the 8th schedule of Indian constitution. The original 14 languages had one language called Kashmiri. It still is part of the 22. But it is part of the original 14 recognized Indian languages. Now let me tell you something. It is the only language among those 14 which is not taught in any school. It has no textbook. It has no teacher. It has no qualification. It has no examination. It has no degree. It has no literature. It has no newspaper. It has no magazine. It has nothing printed in it. You want to read Kashmiri? You have to take out a rupee, 100 rupee note, and among those languages, read this in Persian script, Hathropi, and you will read Kashmiri. That is what they have done to Kashmiri. The only of those 14 languages. And I was saying, language is the...
Not taught in schools in Kashmir?
No, sir.
Sub question.
No textbook, no school, no degree, no qualification, no examination, no teachers, nothing. No official work. No newspaper, no textbook, nothing. No literature. Why? Kashmir has chosen for itself a language called Urdu. Same Urdu, which was not born in Kashmir, but more than 1,000 kilometers away in the corridor between Delhi and Lucknow and Farrukhabad. The same language which was the language of mobilization for India's partition. The same language against which Bangladesh revolted and came out of Pakistan because they sought to annihilate Bengali the way Kashmiri is being annihilated, to be replaced by Urdu. The same language which has annihilated local languages in Pakistan. Do you know in Punjab's provincial assembly, if you speak, stand up and speak in Punjabi, your words will be expunged. Pakistan has killed its own native languages of Sindhi, of Balochi, of Pashto and Punjabi, and Balti and Dardi in Gilgit and Baltistan. You talk about plurality, sir. You talk about, I told you what plurality suffers when I gave you an example between Yemen and Morocco. There is no plurality, sir. And let me come back to our resettlement. You said, I must say that we will not live in separate colonies. I asked you in the very beginning, I don't know how many of you have lived as minority Hindus surrounded by hostile non-Hindu majorities. When we were targeted and killed and cleansed from Kashmir Valley, we were living as spread out Hindus all over. We didn't have ghettos. Despite hostility, we lived there. We had to come out because we could not live there anymore. Those of my friends who say my houses were burnt by the students, by the friends who we played cricket with, try telling him to go back to the same house and live with the same neighbors. There was an engineer, telecom engineer, Balkrishan Ganju. Terrorists came to look for him. His family hid him in the rice drum at the attic. They searched entire house, couldn't find him, they were leaving. Because in Kashmir, in mohallas, houses are very close to each other. You open a window, you can see, look into another's house. When they were leaving, the lady from the next house called them back. She said, I saw him going up in the attic. Look for him there. They came back, went up to the attic, opened the rice drum, shot him dead in that drum on his head. Try telling his family to live in the same neighborhood. Try telling me my house has been encroached and completely vandalized by my neighbors. We are not going back to Kashmir because we are nostalgic about those lanes. We are not going back to Kashmir because I somehow want to revisit the temples, the holy places, which I really miss going back to. I am not going back to Kashmir because I like the climate, I like the apple, I like the lakes, I like the river. I want to go back to Kashmir because if I live out another generation or two, I will not be Kashmiri anymore. My children will not be Kashmiri anymore. I am going back to relive now as a community. To rebuild my community, to rebuild that identity, to nourish my knowledge of language and literature, which I can do only when I live together amongst my own. Not live as a soft target, not live as a hostage in the hands of jihadis who can turn my neck and butcher me as some kind of a ransom to this country called India. This is what they have done when people return to their villages. What happened in Vandahama massacre in 1998? What happened in Sangrampura massacre? What happened in Nadimarg massacre? Not even 2-year-olds were spared. Kalashnikov magazines were emptied on children, defenseless children, because they thought if they returned, then what would we have achieved? It took us great effort to cleanse them all out. And these massacres took place. Because they went back to the same villages to live in the same homes, they thought the worst was over. It is easy to theorize about things.
Next question. Next question.
Hello. Hello. Sir, I will not give any speech. I will just come to question. Do you think that throwing Hindu Kashmiri from Kashmir is a part of a global jihad? Do you think that?
Throwing a Hindu Kashmiri out of Kashmir is
part of global jihad.
So long as, I mean, this is by extension. Because Kashmiri separatist movement is part of aggressive Islamic assertion, which even lot of peaceful, reasonable Muslims don't agree with. But Indian state doesn't stand with those peaceful, moderate Muslims. Indian state goes knocking at the doors of jihadis and is willing to be humiliated outside their door, not being even met. But is not standing with those who, if given security, if given encouragement, will stand up for you. I will tell you who broke the back of insurgency. There was a gentleman called Kukka Pare. I don't know how many of you from here are from Kashmir. You're from Kashmir? Have you heard of Kukka Pare? Can you tell them who Kukka Pare was? Yes. Kukka Pare was one of the Muslim boys who went across the border, got training. In the course of getting training, arms and ammunition, also realized the reality of this jihad in Pakistan. He came back, he surrendered. He created an organization called Ikhwan of surrendered Kashmiri militants. They broke the back of this jihadi insurgency in 90s. It was he who enabled the government of India to hold elections in 1996. In 1990 we left. In 1990 chief minister left. The then chief minister Farooq Abdullah fled not only Kashmir, he fled India, he went to London, he used to play golf. He wasn't even available. For 6 years it was governor's rule. And in 96, when the elections were held, he came back, contested elections, became chief minister again. It happened because people like Kukka Pare, people like Liaquat, people like Ashfaq Majid, they broke the back of the same insurgency of which they were part. Now what happened? When Kukka Pare was shot dead, not even district commissioner went to his funeral. If this is what the state does to the patriots and offers security to those who abuse and accuse India day in and day out, who will stand up for India? Who will fight this jihad? Who will stand up for this against this militancy? This government, this state, in its erroneous understanding of Kashmir, tries throwing money at those who throw grenades at them. That is how Kashmir has been brought to such a pass. We have very little understanding of Kashmir here in this polity. We think we need to give them jobs. Whereas Gilani has repeated himself ad nauseam that even if you pave our roads with gold, we will not stop asking for Pakistan. This is not about development. This is not about jobs. This is not about industry. This is not about economy. This is not about secularism, socialism. He says so. He says, Islam ke taluk se, Islam ke hawale se, hum sab Pakistani hai aur Pakistan hamara hai. That is his sum and substance of politics. Thank you.
Next question.
Please.
Let him.
We are not united, is what is often said. You see, it is not because we are not united that this has happened. We are kept apart from each other because of various reasons. And I'll just cite one example to you. In 93, when Pakistan moved a resolution against India in Geneva in UNHRC, United Nations Human Rights Council, the then Prime Minister, Narasimha Rao, sent a delegation from India under the leadership of then Leader of Opposition, Atal Bihari Vajpayee. He was assisted by the Minister of State for Foreign Affairs, Salman Khurshid. The optics were suggesting that India is unitedly going to United Nations. It's not the government of India. It is Indian delegation fighting the accusations of human rights violations against India by Pakistan. Panun Kashmir also went. And there, Panun Kashmir was encouraged to present to the UNHRC that what is happening in Kashmir is not a freedom struggle. It is ethnic cleansing caused by religious extremism, which meets all the definitions of UN covenants on genocide. When this was heard and the evidence was offered, the debate got little more heated up, and Pakistan, when they kept insisting that Kashmir is the unfinished agenda of partition, T.N. Kaul, our seasoned diplomat from India, he said if partition was about dividing Indian subcontinent along religious lines, and if Kashmir is the unfinished agenda of that partition, are you ready to take back more than 10 crore Muslims along with Kashmir? At that time, Iran realized and withdrew support to that resolution, and that resolution fell. UNHRC did not pass that resolution. We came back. In Delhi, we moved NHRC, National Human Rights Commission, and we told them what happened to us 4 years back. It was 94. Was nothing short of genocide. Justice Venkatachalaya at that time was the UNHRC chairman. He also recorded that it was akin to genocide. I don't know why he used the word akin, but he, in his own wisdom, used that. And he sent a notice to Government of India. And Government of India at that time sent a written submission to NHRC that this was a... The word they used was voluntary migration. We told them, but in order to get rid of this resolution, you yourself admitted that this is ethnic cleansing. which amounts to genocide as identified under the Covenants of United Nations. That's when we realize that when it comes to the state itself, they are unwilling to take responsibility because it is embarrassing. If you accept that this is a genocide, then you as a government, as a country, what did you do about it? In order to escape that responsibility, in order to shirk that responsibility, you want to sweep this entire issue under the carpet? So this is what we are, when we tell them, we cry aloud, we are told, hang on, don't scream, don't shout, don't embarrass India. Something will be done, something is being done, and nothing gets done. And they are the ones who, in order to avoid a united stand from this community, keep catering to individual whims and fancies, keep cultivating individual voices in order to create a dissonance. And we, because we don't want to embarrass our own government, we don't drag them outside. We have two options left. Either we become a nuisance, pick up a gun, start throwing grenades like others do, or just simply disappear, not exist, go quiet and simply pass like a ship in the dark. This is Hobson's choice. Sometimes our own community wonders, because this government, this state is unwilling to acknowledge you even as a leverage, as an asset. We proved to be an asset in 93, right? In UNHRC, where you cited our case in order to defeat that resolution. But as soon as that was met, you start kowtowing to the same jihadis, going and knocking at the doors of the same jihadis, funding the same jihadis who trouble you. Not use us and not reach out to us, who actually were shifted out of Kashmir, shunted out of Kashmir, because they stood for India. So it is a paradox, and we are living it.
Now, just three more questions.
Hello, sir. Audible? I'm Ashish, fifth year student at Department of Humanities and Social Sciences. So my question is, one very prominent thing we see in the discourse of Kashmir is demonization of security forces. So as a Kashmiri minority, how do you see the role of security force? Kashmir? Thank you.
See, demonization of security forces is widespread and prevalent. But primarily because it is the security forces that do not allow you to descend into anarchy. And it is these security forces who distinguish us between a state like India and a state like Pakistan. Within the first 3-4 days of trouble, when Burhan Wani was killed in an encounter, the total number of incidents that took place was about 620 odd. And in 620 incidents, the total casualty were about 1100 or so. Anywhere in the world, this is the lowest ratio for injury to incidents. In total number of injuries over 2 months, which crossed about 10,000, more than half were security forces. This is unprecedented anywhere in the world. Now, those security forces who take such blows, who soak in such punishment in order to observe restraint, they earn a good name for you. And you demonize them. If you demonize security forces, you actually weaken the will of a state to survive. Especially a state which you are targeted through your jihadi onslaught. You demonize the security forces, you are actually corroding the sword arm, the shield, the scabbard of that state. So they are going for our jugular. And we need to understand why.
Next question.
Hi, I didn't have a question. I just want to add something to what you said. There is a connection between Tamil Nadu and Kashmir. A saint born in Sri Perambudur, which is 50 kilometers from here, Ramanujacharya, he, you know, in his evolution of knowledge, he says, that I want to write my explanation on Brahma Sutra and Bhagavad Gita, I have to go to Kashmir because the Pandits are sitting there. So he goes from Sri Perambudur, which is Chennai really, all the way to Sharada Peetha. And so there is that connection and it's recorded. So I'm really glad that. one more point. Similar thing to what happened to Kashmir has also happened in Goa. Right? There, of course, it was Portuguese people. And you know, some of those stories are very similar.
Yes.
What happened to the temples, how the people were treated.
Yes.
So there is that parallel also.
The Goan Inquisitions, yes. What he mentioned, I'm reminded of another visitor from Tamil Nadu. His name was Madhuraj Yogi. He, after hearing the fame of Abhinav Gupta, travels all the way up to Kashmir to meet Abhinav Gupta. And then when he writes about him, two short sentences, he says, what every other scholar says is as if written on water. What Abhinav Gupta says is as if written on heart, is how he describes Abhinav Gupta and his intellect. His name was Madhuraj Yogi. He traveled all the way up from Madurai in Tamil Nadu to Kashmir. There are other exchanges. There is a poet called Bilhana who wrote Chaur Panchashika, who also wrote some of the most cherished poetry in Sanskrit. There was a Vikramank Dev Charit he wrote, Bilhana. He was from Kashmir. He came and worked in the court of Krishnadevaraya, Chalukya kings. So Kashmir and rest of the country or South India had great connection and vibrant intellectual exchange. And I cite these examples only to, you know, nail the lies that Kashmir belongs to Central Asia and India has nothing to do with that state. I keep coming across absolute lies. Kashmir is unimaginable without India, and India is unimaginable without Kashmir.
Last question.
I'm asking, there is a lot of Sikhs in also in Kashmir. What was the role of Sikhs during the exodus of this Kashmiri country?
Extremely important and good question. These Sikhs came to Kashmir when Maharaja Ranjit Singh liberated Kashmir from Pathans. The fifth guru had come, sixth guru, Chhati Padshahi, had also come to Kashmir. There is a Gurdwara to his memory. Now, people ask me, there were about 60,000 Kashmiris, Sikhs, when more than almost 500,000 Kashmiri Hindus had to flee Kashmir. Why didn't Sikh flee Kashmir? Those who know would realize, in 1990s, Khalistan movement was at its peak. In 84, Operation Blue Star had happened, which triggered this movement. And the most virulent phase was, I mean, and we had to flee Kashmir in 1990, so just 6 years later. At that time, Pakistan was funding and fomenting both the militancies. The Sikh terrorists of Babar Khalsa and Dal Khalsa were being trained virtually in the same camps. Punjab militancy preceded Kashmir militancy. And therefore, Sikhs were considered as assets in Kashmir. They thought that Punjab and Kashmir geographical continuity, these two agitations will support each other. They'll become force multipliers, and therefore Sikh population in Kashmir is not hostile population. Two, it was not as spread out as Hindus of Kashmir. So they were betting on the tenuous
patriotism of Sikhs, especially much fewer in numbers, and that too confined to few pockets, and they didn't touch those Sikhs in the hope that, you know, in the eventuality of Khalistan movement becoming stronger, Kashmir and Punjab will rise together against the Indian Union. But when Clinton came in 2000, in order to send a message to the American president that there is a problem called Kashmir, they killed 38 Sikhs in the Sikh village of Chhati Singhpura. When Clinton was here in Delhi, they committed that massacre in Kashmir. There is no love lost between the two. And I must tell you, and I keep telling this to whoever cares to listen. In 1671, when Mughals ruled Kashmir, very often people say that Sufis have contributed a great deal. Sorry, that was the reign of Aurangzeb. Aurangzeb was helped into annexing the kingdom, the throne, by Naqshbandis who were Sufis. These Naqshbandis favored Aurangzeb over his brother Dara Shikoh, who was an eclectic Sufi himself, who was a great scholar of Sanskrit, who translated Indian scriptures into Persian, who studied them in Srinagar, in Kashmir. There is a place called Peer Mahal above Chashma Shahi where he used to stay. He was beheaded by Aurangzeb and gifted, his head was gifted to his father, Shah Jahan, in Agra, as a birthday gift by Aurangzeb. That Aurangzeb, when plotted by Naqshbandi Sufis to start the proselytization of India, to start the conversions in India, he said, where do we start? The best place to start is Kashmir. So his governor of Kashmir then, his name was Iftikhar Khan. When he started an extremely virulent program of conversion, my ancestors, led by Kripa Ram Dutt, came in a jatha to Anandpur Sahib, the town which was built by Guru Tegh Bahadur. Guru Tegh Bahadur was told that please save the Janeyu and Tilak in Kashmir. He says, what happened? He says, this is what the Mughaliya Sultanate wants. He says, go tell the Nawab, why do you go after individual conversions? You convert our Guru, all of us will convert. So Guru Tegh Bahadur was taken prisoner at Sirhind. He refused to convert. He was brought to Delhi. His choicest, chosen, dearest disciples were cut to pieces in front of his eyes. Bhai Matidas, Bhai Satidas, he refused to budge. Then he himself was beheaded. It is this beheading of the ninth Guru, Guru Tegh Bahadur, for the sake of Kashmiri Pandits, that led Guru Gobind Singh to create Khalsa. And Sikhs were born out of this. We owe our existence. I don't know whether my ancestors would have remained Hindus, would have continued to wear Janeyu and Tilak, had this supreme sacrifice by the ninth Guru not been made. So, betting on Sikhs to be a fifth column in this country and helping Kashmir is wrong. But at that time, a lot of people went mad. So, they thought that they could count on this segment and they didn't touch them. That's the reason they stayed back.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. I would like Dr. P. A. Ramakrishna to felicitate our guest on behalf of Vande Mataram with a memento. Everyone, please stay for the national anthem. Now I would request Professor P. A. Ramakrishna to give the vote of thanks.
I would like to say this. Thank you for educating us. Thank you for showing to us some really barbaric acts that have gone on in Kashmir. And I have been a reader of all these things. And still, I missed out on all the things that you talked about. Thank you very much for educating us. I hope we now have a better understanding of the Kashmir problem after your talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I would like to thank our guest for taking out his precious time and addressing the audience about Kashmir issue. I would also like to thank our faculty members as well as the audience for joining us here. We have come towards the end of this program, but it won't be complete without singing the national anthem. So I would request all of you to stand up for national anthem.
Jai Gana Mana Adhinayaka Jaya Hai Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravida Utkal Vanga Vindhya Himachal Yamuna Ganga Uchala Jaladhi Taranga Tava Shubha Name Jage Tava Shubha Aashish Mange Gahe Tava Jaya Gatha Jana Gana Mangala Dayaka Jaya He Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Jaya He Jaya He Jaya He, Jaya 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 He.
Thanks. I would also like to invite all of you for our next lecture by Rajya Sabha MP Dr. Narendra Jadhav on Ambedkar's economics and his vision for India. Thanks again.